horrible tragedy in Royal Oak today. A fired postal worker, apparently very angry over losing his job, walked into the main post office armed with a gun just before 9 o'clock this morning. He hunted down his victims and shot them one by one before then finally turning the gun on himself. He has been identified as 31-year-old Thomas McIlvane of Oak Park. His co-workers describe him as, quote, waiting like a time bomb to explode.
I started in the post office in May of 1967. I was 16 years old, I was in high school, and President Johnson came through with the Youth Opportunity Program. I became a union steward, union officer. I got into the 204B program, which is a management training program. I was a branch manager of Franklin, Michigan. 1983, I was promoted to the postmaster's position, a level 21 job, plus I was given the responsibility for the Royal Oak City delivery operations. In May of 88, I was promoted permanently to that position. I'm in a group that's less than 1% of the managers in the Postal Service. My goal was to be Postmaster General. All that ended with the mass murder by Tom McIlvane. The devil has a name. I have nothing. I don't even have a job or a title. The vigilante mode had kicked in. Now there was a different issue added to the murder, the issue of autocratic management. How can they say mail was being delivered late or not at all? It wasn't. It wasn't. It just shows you the type of campaign orchestrated against me. When they investigated the shooting and they came in, the Postal Service asked me if I read Mein Kampf out on the workroom floor, if I killed my mother. Everybody was afraid to be around me. My own wife told me last week that she wouldn't want to be in the same post office with me. I feel betrayed by an organization that I've devoted my entire life to. My job was everything to me. I never had a chance, never gave myself a chance to do a lot of things in life. The tragedy with Tom McIlvane started before he even got to the post office. And 5 innocent people died. There's people that worked in that building that will remember that the rest of their life. I was sitting in the administrative offices, which is off the workroom floor, and I heard somebody yelling, "Gew, Gew, I'm gonna get you." There was a man standing in the middle of the unit screaming at another carrier. And I asked him to please stop, and I said, "What's the problem?" He says, "Gew." I said, "You're gonna have to stop right now or leave the building." That was my first time that I had met Tom McIlvane. People were afraid to talk to him. Different employees would come up to me and express their fear of him. He had told the supervisor he had taken a tank in the service and drove it over his commanding officer's car. That turned out to be true. A call came in, the city police calling to say a carrier had just assaulted a customer. And our first response was to go get the carrier off the street and bring him back to the office. It turned out to be Tom McIlvane. We had a situation where one of our employees had allegedly struck a customer. We had violence. We had to do something about it. McIlvane, when the postal inspectors called him and said they were coming over his house, threatened the postal inspectors. It takes a lot to get fired in the post office. And the employees have access to the grievance procedure all the way. Tom kept going one step further, one step further, one step further. There was no corrective approach on his part. We're telling him, there's no reason for you to be out this late. There's no reason for you not to deliver mail. There's no reason for you to bring mail back. And his union steward is saying, well, you're picking on him. He wanted a cart to do his route. And it was snowing. He was pushing a cart through the snow to deliver mail. Didn't make no sense. When someone's not doing their route, they're spending as much time as they can doing nothing. Well, you gotta find out why. We didn't just jump into discipline and start saying, hey, he's a bad employee, we're gonna get rid of him. I asked McIlvane to come in through his supervisor and bring his steward with him. And I started the meeting by saying, "Tom, you're going to get fired." Tom McIlvane was fired for threatening a supervisor. 2 months later, in October, my secretary came into my office at Southfield and said there's a person on the phone, and the person had given the labor relations man's name. And I picked up the phone, and it was Tom McIlvane, and he threatened me. He said, "All fingers point to you, and I'm going to get you, I'm going to kill you." And I was stunned. I called the Postal Inspection Service. I called the Southfield Police Department, and I made a police report that I was threatened. After I called the police, the first thing I did was a security review of the Southfield Post Office. And we had combination locks on one door. I did something to protect the other doors. I had a buzzer system put in the lobby. He had a Jeep, a tan-colored Jeep. And I said, "If you see a tan-colored Jeep out there, let me know." I didn't have a secure home. It's out in the country, it's patrolled by the sheriff. And because McIlvane was calling me, I figured that if he really wanted to get me, he'd find all these things out. He'd stalk me. I felt stalked. I have a rather long driveway to where I park my car on the lake. And I figured that he could be out there any morning. It was dark, there's no street lights out, and kill me before I got to my car. When he was arrested for these phone calls he made to me by the Southfield Police, the Director of Public Safety, Jerry Tobin, called me at home on a Sunday, said he was picked up yesterday. He's very dangerous. "I can't tell you enough, Bill, that you're in danger. Your life is in danger." If he was going to kill me, he was going to kill me. So I took whatever action I could. I made a list of my belongings or my things for my wife to look at, how to take care of things after I died. We went to court. We presented everything in trial, and the prosecuting attorney thought we had a case. I called the judge afterwards, and the judge said the jury told us it's not that they didn't believe you, but there was reasonable doubt because you didn't have tape recordings or some type of physical evidence. McIlvane continued after that to call me. And one Monday morning in April of 91, I came to work and there was a message. I'd gone to a meeting first to call the Oak Park Police Department, a Sergeant Kane. I still have the slip. Sergeant Kane said McIlvane came in the police department yesterday and said he was going to commit homicide against you. We thought you should know this. The union paper says, "Don't get mad, get even." So all these things are going through my mind. My God, what is this man being told? Now he's gone into the Oak Park police station, says he's applied for a gun permit, and he's going to commit a homicide against me. He said that I was having somebody call his house. He had two anonymous calls, and when he picked the phone up, they said, "Don't do it." And the police lieutenant told me on the phone, "I know you didn't do that." I said, "Absolutely. Nor did I have anybody do that. Don't even know the man's phone number. Don't want to know. But I want to know what can be done." He said, "Well, it's on the police report." When I read on the police report that McIlvane said he applied for a gun permit, I'm thinking handgun. I'm thinking this goes beyond being a hunter, because you don't hunt deer or pheasant, whatever, with a handgun. So I called Jerry Tobin. And I said, "Jerry, what can we do about this? I mean, we got to do something. The guy's getting a gun permit." And Jerry called me back about an hour later and said, "He didn't apply for a gun permit, he has one." I called the steward in Royal Oak. I wanted everyone to be aware because I wanted somebody, somewhere, to get through to him to stop this. Because it was obvious the system wasn't going to stop it. I was a dead man. I had no other belief than I was going to be dead. And I wanted to do what I could to protect everybody else. It was a hard reality. In 6 to 7 months, that you see in the movies and everything else, that somebody was threatening my life and nobody could do anything about it. I talked to the former union president. Hey, he said, people that talk about it don't do it. Call the inspectors. It's a police matter. The police are doing what they could. We go to court. The system says you're innocent. What do? You wait to die. Before you even hear the name, before you even hear what post office, you know. You know. Chris Carlisle used to tell me, it's only gonna hurt for a minute. But it hurts forever. I happened to be talking to a director from Royal Oak who called me on his car phone, and I was interrupted by my secretary in Detroit who said there's an emergency call for you. I heard bullets, I heard somebody yell, dial 911. I thought, oh my God. Oh my God. I used to stop in church every morning. On the day of the shooting, I went to church, and it was off the beaten path, off the expressway. Church was in Royal Oak, the Shrine of the Little Flower. And I went to Mass and received communion, and I was going to go to Royal Oak, which would have put me there at the time of the shooting. And something told me not to do it.
The mayhem that erupted after Thomas McIlvane apparently took revenge today was not only predicted, but possibly could have been prevented.
McIlvane entered the west dock door at approximately 9:45, 9:47 a.m. He immediately went to Chris Carlisle's office.
He warned them that something tragic like this was going to happen. If he was fired, he would come back and start to shoot and start to kill.
He shot Chris Carlisle in the head and face and neck, dead. He had a sawed-off rifle concealed under a raincoat. Then he shot an acting supervisor and a supervisor who died. He then went to the next delivery unit where he shot a fellow carrier. He then went into the personnel office where several people were injured, including Keith Suzuki, who was shot dead, murdered. People that were hiding under cases, hiding under desks. He reloaded his gun, went up towards Mr. Priscilla's office, jiggled the door, couldn't get in, it was locked. Priscilla was in his office having a meeting when the shooting spree started, and his office was always locked when he was in it. That's just the way it was. Mr. Priscilla was one of the people that called 911. They always play that on the radio. Downstairs and shot himself to death. He certainly gave warnings that he would do something. He kept going forward with it and forward with it and forward with it. I tried to do something. I tried to get him help through the court system, but I failed. I did the best that I could, and it wasn't enough.
Didn't win that round, and he didn't last long in the Marine Corps. He was forced out for threatening an officer. McIlvane's temper cost him a job at the Royal Oak Post Office as well. He was fired last year, but friends say he believed he'd win his arbitration case, for his future was at stake. Federal investigators will now begin sifting through the clues Thomas McIlvane might have left behind. They'll begin piecing together the portrait of a man who some say was pushed to his limit and fought back with violence.
Within 45 minutes of the tragedy, the news media was already calling me in Detroit, wanting statements. I was told before the day was up that I was not to make statements and I was not to talk to the press by the Postal Service. During the next couple of days, a lot of information started being unfolded or released by the different organizations with a negative impact on myself, Dan Priscilla, Chris Carlisle, and some of the other managers. And this basically set the tone for the scapegoating and what was going to happen. The union started to picket, started to write letters, started to generate news stories. They made it into a union labor management issue, and it wasn't. It was a very obvious, emotionally disturbed individual who needed help. After the shooting, one of the union people was saying that I was out to get Tom McIlvane, Chris Carlisle was out to get Tom McIlvane. That's not true. We had to deal with Tom McIlvane. Effective managers were targets, and I was the number one. People were mad I took overtime away. I tried to run an efficient operation. I made every budget and every goal I ever had. You're paramilitary, you're autocratic. It's not bad to want someone to do a job. When you're an achiever, you're the odd man out. For years, they've used me as a hatchet man, as a person who went into assignments considered undesirable or nobody else wanted. And I always got positive results. The post office wanted me as a scapegoat. They didn't know how to shut it down. Ultimately, everything I did that I was requested to do and required to do was used against me. I felt so bad because I couldn't even go to the funerals of people that I worked for and respected. That I couldn't go up to a wife, a husband, a mother, and a father and tell them how sorry I was that their son or daughter was murdered. The union started showing me in their magazine or their paper on the cover, wearing swastikas, being compared to a Nazi, wearing armbands that said NP for non-productive. That's what it came down to after 25 years, 26 years, is political expediency. So they put me in a job that I wasn't even qualified for, a job that I wasn't permitted to do because I couldn't sign anything or certify it. So from August until I left work in December for 4 months, I was under house arrest. I was in a beautifully renovated old post office in Birmingham, probably worth all kind of money if it was sold for the Postal Service. Given a mahogany desk, a mahogany bookcase, leather couch, but nothing to do. Now I had been judged and sentenced with no trial, with no charges, with no justice. I was sitting in my new office. It came on the news that there was a problem in Royal Oak. That a supervisor or ex-supervisor had been arrested for bringing two briefcases into the post office. A disgruntled ex-supervisor. This lady had mentioned me as a possible target. She brought two briefcases into Royal Oak and they called the bomb squad. And I sat there watching it with the post office attorney and I said, you know, I'll probably get blamed for this. And sure enough, 2 or 3 days later, the chief steward in Southfield went in the paper and said, this lady was all these things because I made her that way. She also had a gun. She had a gun and she was going to take revenge. What are you going to do? 2 days after the shooting in front of our home on a highway, there was a hit and run. And my wife discovered the body when she went out to the mailbox on the road to get the paper. And we were horrified. some young man was killed by a young lady who was later convicted of it, driving a black car. I've had nightmares ever since the shootings. Couldn't sleep. About what's happened. About being killed myself. About having my family killed. I constantly think about the fact of being blamed and being made responsible for something I had no control over. And it continues today. One union steward continues to say and infer that we should be punished. For what? For doing our job? I believe, based on the anonymous letters that I've got and some of the phone calls I've received at home, that there are people out there who would harm me.
The devil has a name.